Good morning. Welcome to the house of the Lord. This, the fourth Sunday in Advent. I want to welcome you and thank you for being here this morning. Thank you to all who are joining us online, perhaps watching via Facebook. God bless you and thank you for connecting this morning to worship our living God, the giver of all good things, the giver and the gift in the person of Jesus Christ. In this Advent season, we have been encouraged week after week to prepare our hearts and lives for the coming of the Christ child. And not only the child, but we remember throughout the whole of the liturgical year, we are encouraged to know the one who is our Savior and Lord, who died for us, who was raised from the dead for our sake, and who lives for us today. And so it's with that same joy and excitement that we come this Sunday morning to worship the Lord. And I pray that your hearts are prepared to worship. I want to offer a word of encouragement to you from the Old Testament. Anybody know that there's some encouragement in the Old Testament? The prophet Isaiah, though he was indeed a weeping prophet, had some words of encouragement. He prophesied that there would indeed be a better day. Anybody know that there's going to be a better day? We're thankful today for the gift of Jesus Christ, who is that better day fulfilled. He is indeed the good news. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6. Hear this word of encouragement, church. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders, and he will be called, and perhaps this morning you need to be reminded of one of these incredible characteristics, one of these incredible, wonderful gifts from God in the person of Jesus Christ. He is our wonderful counselor. He is the mighty God. He is our everlasting Father, and he, church, is our Prince of Peace. Amen. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness. From that time and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this great thing. The zeal of the Lord God Almighty will accomplish this great thing. Church, that's good news. Is that good news? I believe that God accomplishes every promise that God has made. And so we're so thankful today that in this Advent season, we can be a people who are invited to prepare. And my prayer for you this morning is that you are preparing for the coming of Christ. This morning, I want to thank you. If you look around, there are some of us who may have a few bags under our eyes. We practiced for 6 or 8 weeks for a Christmas play. We had an incredible Christmas play last evening, A King is Coming to Town. We had a lot of turnout of support from the church and the community, and we're so thankful for all those who were able to make it. And thank you for your support. We had a great evening. A couple of announcements that tie into that is we're going to continue to celebrate and prepare for the coming of Christ. This evening at 6 o'clock, right here on our own property, we have the Living Nativity. How many of you have ever participated in the Living Nativity? We have the Living Nativity this evening at 6 o'clock. We're going to have live animals, of course, out on the front lawn. We're going to have the addition of the petting zoo this year. So you'll be animals participating in the birth of Christ. But to the side, we're going to have animals that you can actually interact with and pet. There's going to be cookies and hot chocolate and coffee. A wonderful time to connect together in the season of Christmas and Advent and also with our community. We're excited. Last evening, we had about 140, 50-some people at the play. 200 and some told us on Facebook they were coming. I checked this morning, we have about 862 people who tell us they're coming to the Living Nativity this evening. So the percentage of that is we're expecting 500 or 600 people, according to the play last night. So you want to come early, you want to be here, you want to greet our community. We're going to have a greeting table, we're going to have song sheets this year so we can sing along with the soundtrack of the birth of Christ. You'll note on our schedule that this year we're doing it a little differently. We're not going to just have it run in cycle. From 6 to 6:30 is the telling of the birth of Christ and the live nativity. 6:30 to 7, the petting zoo, hot chocolate cookies. We'll do the play again from 7 to 7:30. 7:30 to 8, petting zoo, fellowship, hot chocolate, and cookies. So you may want to pick your time to come, or you want to come and stay the whole evening. You're invited to do so. Come and enjoy the Living Nativity this evening. As we move into Christmas week, we're excited as well about the Christmas Eve service. on the 24th at 7 p.m. here at the church. Please know this will be a Christmas Eve candlelight service. I would invite you to prepare your family to be here as well. Invite friends and neighbors to participate as we anticipate the coming of the Christ. And on Christmas Sunday morning, yay, the birthday of Christ, church, we're going to gather to worship on Jesus' birthday. I'll never forget a few years ago at a former appointment, someone said to me, Pastor Don, Christmas is on Sunday this year. Are we having church? I said, of course we're having church. And the person replied, well, that ruins Christmas. I thought two things. I can't believe you said that. And I can't believe you said it to me, of all people. But church, we're gathering at 10 a.m. on Christmas Sunday morning, the birthday of the King, in the fellowship hall, not in the sanctuary. No 8:30, no 11, 10 o'clock worship service. We're going to have sing-along carol music. The whole fellowship hall is set up for an incredible opportunity of worship. And here's the incredible thing. Donuts, coffee, and hot chocolate, and come in your Christmas PJs if you would like. We're inviting you to come comfortable. So come, fellowship hall, 10 a.m., Christmas Day, songs around the piano, the telling of the birth of Christ, donuts, coffee, hot chocolate, and your PJs. Doesn't that sound great? Yes, we're going to worship the King. Without any further ado this morning, without any other announcements, I would invite you to use your bulletin as your guide for the week. I'm going to invite you to stand, church. I can see the excitement on your faces. You can't wait. We're going to stand up together, and we're going to be officially called to worship this day. The call to worship is found in your bulletin, as well as projected on the walls this morning for you. You will be the people. Pastor Daniel will be our leader this morning, and we will respond accordingly. Let's stand together as we are able to officially begin our worship.
Let us enter into this call to worship together. We are always looking for evidence that God is with us.
That sign is the one to come, the one God is giving.
Emmanuel, God is with us. God's love realized in the gift of Jesus.
And so we lift our voices in praise. Hallelujah. God is responding in love and hope.
Let us come before God with expectant hearts and spirits.
Let us be ready to receive the blessed gift of the Savior.
Amen. Please remain standing as now we are going to voice our praise together. O Come All Ye Faithful, a favorite Christmas song of ours. United Methodist Hymn Book, the Red Hymnal 237. We're going to be singing verses 1, 2, 3, and 6. And so with the Christmas spirit reminded of the love of Jesus Christ, let us sing this song together. 234, I'm sorry.
Come and behold Him, born the King.
other.
Good morning. The reading is from Luke 2, 10 through 14. Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in clothes and lying in a manger. Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth, peace to those on whom his favor rests." As we light the candle of love, we celebrate the announcement of the coming King and the greatest of God's love revealed through the Christ child. For God so loved the world that he gave us his Son.
Let us pray. Father, we thank you for revealing yourself through Jesus, and we praise you for the greatness of your love. Help us to share your peace and love with others and live our lives more like Christ every day. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you for lighting the candle, and today we get to see the four candles, hope, joy, peace, and love, all lit, and it's a reminder of the characteristics of Jesus. And so today and at this moment, let us go into a time of prayer as we lift up prayers and the requests of our family, but also give praise to the Lord for hope, joy, peace, and love. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you so much for this moment that we get to just simply pray, giving praise to you for these candles, the symbolism of hope, joy, love, and peace. Characters of you, Jesus, as you come into this world, you have given each of these elements to us. At the same time, you have taught us through the blood and the body that you have died for us. To live our lives with hope, joy, peace, and love, and to share that with those around us. And so, Lord, we first take a moment to give praise to you. Lord, in our prayer, we want to lift up the praises of all the community coming together through the Sherbourne Food Pantry and the help through the donation of the cold weather items. We give thanks to you, God, for you are a good God, answering prayers on the prayer list that we have. But we lift up also the prayers of our family, the many health concerns of our Beulah family, praying specifically for Neely Owen, Willard Wenrich Jr., Gina Richardson, Walt Hayden, Rhonda Anderson, Sandra Johnson, Pat Compton, Dolly Covington, Jane Spain, Carol Morris, Nancy Corden, Jennifer Walters, BJ Sexton, Jackie Holt, Bonnie Garrison, and a prayer also lifted up to the Cuddy family as they find peace in their season of loss. God, we lift up our community up to you as Christmas is an opportunity not just to pray for those in need of prayer, but to also act and give to our neighbors and those in need. And we pray that this Christmas season may truly be the hope, joy, peace, and love that is lived in us. And together as the body of Christ, as we lift up the prayers of our family and we give praise to you for what you have done for us, we're going to pray now together in the prayer that you have taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite the ushers to come and as we give our tithes and offerings. All rise for the singing of our doxology. Pray for this offering. Gracious God, we thank you once again for just this opportunity to pray. And right now we pray specifically for our offering. We pray that this offering truly let it not just be an offering of our finances, but let it be an offering of our hearts as well, as we pray that this offering will be used for your glory. In this Christmas season, we pray for the hope, joy, peace, and love that is fully overwhelming and abound in us. And so, Lord, let this offering reflect that. We love you, we thank you, and in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated, and I will invite Terry Griggs to come up and read our scripture for us.
morning. I am reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save the people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Amen. Thank you for that scripture reading. And apologies, I know in the bulletin the scripture is different, but we will highlight that scripture, the John scripture, in my sermon later. But the highlight for today is Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. And we're focusing on the word Emmanuel. But before I dive into that, first, good morning. Oh, wait, I'm so sorry. I totally forgot the children. please, the children will be going with Carol Zimmerman to Children's Church. We bless their time as they also have a lesson on the Advent season of hope, joy, peace, and love. I'm so sorry, children. Okay. All right. Well, good morning again. Is it just me? But Christmas is only a week away. But for some reason, the good mornings are not feeling it for some reason, right? Who's excited for Christmas? Right, it should be a majority of us, right? With the gifts and most importantly, Jesus. Right, so can we say good morning one more time? Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Yes. Right, because we celebrate today the last fourth Sunday of Advent, and then next week is Christmas Day. And so I think as we're getting closer to Christmas, our good mornings should be louder and louder. Because truly, it is a good morning. Every Sunday is a good morning as we celebrate really just Jesus and all that he has done for us. But specifically in this season of Advent, of how Jesus' birth truly is this message of Emmanuel, God is with us. I love and I want to thank the choir again for their song, "Jesus, Be at the Center of It All," because, you know, as we see this candle here, the Christ candle, which we will light on Christmas Eve, really represents how Jesus, the King, is the center of it all, center of hope, joy, peace, and love. And so today, our passage comes from Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 to 25. It's a chapter where we talk about and highlight the word Emmanuel. As the first chapter of Matthew first starts off by revealing the genealogy of Jesus, the author of Matthew continues with the event of how Jesus was born in a very unique situation through Joseph and Mary. We just read together in our scripture of how Mary was pregnant through the Holy Spirit, but Joseph was trying to figure that out because, you know, he was thinking, wait, how did this happen? And so he was contemplating, you know, should I divorce her and do it quietly and all of that? But in the midst of Joseph trying to understand the situation, the angel of the Lord comes to Joseph and tells him that Mary is pregnant with Jesus. Mary is pregnant by the power of the Holy Spirit with Jesus. And so the angel tells Joseph, trust in the Lord, be faithful to Mary as you will name your son Jesus. And so Joseph trusts the angel and is faithful. I think the highlight of today's passage for us is what the passage says about the prophecy that was fulfilled. The verse says, "All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. We're going to highlight that word together, Emmanuel, which means God with us. As we enter our fourth Sunday of Advent, we highlight hope, joy, peace, and love. And what brings that all together is the name Emmanuel, which means God with us. You know, one thing every year, I notice that we sing, O come, Emmanuel. And this year in particular, for some reason, I noticed it a little bit extra this year. And I didn't realize, to be honest, maybe it was because I grew up in a more Korean background, so maybe I sang the Korean version of O come, Emmanuel. So it didn't really hit me until I got here that this song is actually really popular. Like across all the churches, it doesn't matter what denomination you're part of, every year the church has to sing O come, Emmanuel at least once. You hear it in churches, you hear it in radio, you hear it in even restaurants and just even markets, depending on where you go. O come, Emmanuel is always sung once. I think people would uproar in this church if we did not sing that song once a year. It's a very popular song because it's so vital in our church culture, in our church of singing, O come, Jesus, God who is with us. And so that got me thinking as I was thinking about this song, O come, Emmanuel. I started thinking, how much or how deeply do we understand the significance of the name Emmanuel, which means God with us? And so as we think about the name Emmanuel, as we read today, I want to spend today expounding on this name, expanding on the name Emmanuel, because as we take a deeper look, as we take a dive into the name, for some of us, this may be just a reminder. For some, this may be something completely new. As we dive into this name, it becomes very significant in our understanding of Jesus, our faith, and this season as we move forward in the name of Jesus Christ. There's two points about the name Emmanuel that I want to share with us today. The two points being, one, Emmanuel means God is literally with us. And number two is that Emmanuel means God is with us yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and forever. I want to first start us off with the first point of how Emmanuel means God is literally with us. We take a look back at the passage that we read in Matthew, verses 21 and 22, again states these words, "All this," the birth of Jesus Christ through Mary, "took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet, the virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel," which means God with us. As we witness chapter 1 of the birth of Jesus through the Virgin Mary, we are pointed to by the author of the Gospel of how Matthew, of the Gospel of Matthew, of how the birth of Jesus through the Virgin was a fulfillment of a prophecy in Isaiah. So if we look at the actual prophecy written in Isaiah chapter 7, verse 14, it says these words exactly. Isaiah 7 says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." Right? So we see the connection between Isaiah 7 and then that being fulfilled by the author of the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 1. What Matthew is doing is acknowledging that Jesus is the fulfillment of this prophecy. It's the fulfillment of this prophecy that Jesus is the son named Emmanuel. But there's something unique and powerful about this prophecy being fulfilled, and there's something unique about the name and its meaning. I want us to look to John chapter 1. We've been reading the Gospel of John during this December Advent season for our Bible reading challenge. And John chapter 1, I want to remind us, starts off by talking about the Word of God. of how it says, in the beginning was the Word, which means Jesus. The Word is Jesus. But in as we know and declare that the Word is God, was with God, and was in the beginning, John chapter 1, verses 14 also reveals how the Word, who is Jesus, who is God, became flesh and made his dwelling among us. John chapter 1, verses 14 talks about of how we have a God who became a human in the form of humanity and lived and dwelled among us. So if Emmanuel means God with us, and if Jesus is Emmanuel, the Son that is fulfilling this prophecy, then doesn't that mean that the birth of Jesus means that God is literally with us? It's not saying that Jesus is a sign or a representation that God is with us. It's a literal statement that God is with you. That the birth of Jesus and living amongst humanity is a literal form that God is with you right now. And this becomes very vital in our understanding about Jesus, because we are called as Christians a lot of times when we're with people to tell others, God is with you. God is with you. In the times of joy and the times of lows, the highs and lows, the times of darkness and the times of light, a lot of times we say, God is with you. But as Christians, we don't just say that as a symbolic gesture, that God is just with us. We say that in a literal way, that Christ lives in you, as Apostle Paul would say in Romans. And as Christ lives in you, we believe in Jesus, Emmanuel, who God is literally with you. When we declare to one another, God is with you, we are saying that God is literally with you. It's a very powerful statement that we have. And the reason why this is so powerful and beautiful is because this is what makes our Christian faith so different and unlike any other. Because very simply, we have a God who came into this world. We have a God who came into this world in the form of flesh to be with us. And the good news is that through God being literally with us, Jesus would go and die so that his death and resurrection would be the salvation that we have. The reason why we light these candles, hope, joy, peace, and love, is a testimony of how God was literally with us, and to die for us, we light the Christ candle, signifying the Savior that we have in Jesus. I think to help better explain this understanding that Christ is literally with us, I want to share with us an excerpt from Pastor David Platt. He's the pastor of McLean Bible Church in Northern Virginia. He did a video, a 60-second apologetics video for the Gospel Coalition. So he tried to explain the gospel in 60 seconds. And the title of his excerpt is, How is Christianity Categorically Different from Every Other Religion? So he takes and sums it up in 60 seconds. I just want to read what he says, and I'm sharing his quote. So I quote David Platt. He says, I was in another country recently, and I was sitting outside of the temple with two other guys, actually from different religions. And they were talking about how all three of our religions were fundamentally the same, just kind of superficially different. And I was listening for a while, and I finally spoke up and I said, it's almost like you guys picture God or whatever you want to call him at the top of a mountain, and we're all at the bottom of a mountain. And I may take this path up and you may take this path up, but in the end, we'll all be in the same place. And they smiled and they said, exactly, you understand. And I looked back at them and said, well, what if I told you that the God at the top of the mountain didn't wait for us to find our way up to him? He actually came down to where we are. They said, well, that would be great. I said, this is the difference. What we find in the Bible is the story of a God who has not left us alone to try to find our way to him. He has come to us, and he has made the way to himself through Jesus. Isn't that so beautiful, the analogy that he uses? I love that imagery to describe our faith and to capture again what he's saying. He's saying that the Christian faith is categorically different from the rest of the world, because while the world sees their God living on this top of the mountain, and it's our job to find ways up this mountain on our own, we have a God. The Christian faith is that we have a God in the name Emmanuel, who literally came down to be with us. We have a God where he lives with us. It's so radical that God will literally be with us. But that is what makes the name Emmanuel so powerful. That's what makes the name Emmanuel so powerful. When we take a moment to understand that Emmanuel, God is with us, is literal, we understand that it's not just a symbol, it's not just a sign, but Emmanuel is manifested literally. The birth of Jesus Christ is a literal statement. It's a literal manifestation that God is with us. If we have that understanding that God, in the birth story, that Emmanuel, God is with us, then when we read scripture, we start to see things a little bit differently. We start to actually see that in many of the stories and in many of the texts that we read, it's how Jesus lives literally with us. Again, I quote Apostle Paul, Christ lives in us. He's not just saying that symbolically, but literally Christ lives in us. John chapter 3, verse 16, which just happens to be the scripture that was read when we lit the candle today, is a scripture that really manifests this literal aspect of God being with us. For God so loved this world, for God so loved the world, that God sent his own Son, so that whoever may believe may not perish but have eternal life. Right? God loved us so much that God sent God's own Son to live with us, to literally be with us. I love the name Emmanuel because it really does signify not just this symbolic statement that God is with you, but when we share it with one another, we're saying these words with power, saying that God is literally with you, that God is wanting to be with you. Every Christmas we sing, O come, Emmanuel, because it's a reminder that the birth of Jesus Christ is a testimony that God is literally with us. And I think it's through this understanding that God is with us that we could understand the second point for today. That Emmanuel means God is with us yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Going back to the excerpt that Pastor David Platt shares, it really resonated with me how he shares that the purpose for Jesus coming to us was not just to be with us, but to make the way so that we could go to the mountaintop led by Jesus. Unlike other religions, as he was sharing, where the focus is you have to find your way to salvation, right? You go up this path or you go up this path, right? He is saying that Christianity is different because Jesus came down to us and is leading us to the top. Jesus is guiding us and walking with us and being the guide in our lives. Isn't that why Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life? Because as Jesus is literally with us, he wants to be with us every single day, to be the way, to be the truth, to be the life. God wants to be with us yesterday. God wants to be with us today. And God wants to be with us tomorrow every single day of our lives. I think that's so beautiful, that every single day that we have a God who loves us so much, not just so that God would be with us, but God would want to walk with us every single day. I think truly what makes the Christian faith so radically different from other religions is that we have a God that is relational. We have a God that loves us so much. That's why John 3:16, I think, sticks out to so many of us. For God so loved the world. Right? We have a God that loves us so much that God sent God's own Son to literally be with us and to walk with us. And Jesus Christ, the good news is that God loved us so much that Jesus would die for us so that we would forever be with God every single day. I think that what makes the Christian faith so beautiful, that it is a personal relationship. God is seeking to be with us. God is seeking to walk with us. And in our season of life, there is moments of highs and lows. There's moments of joys and sadness. There's moments of darkness and light. But the good news is that we have a God that is with us in our hearts, literally, but also God is with us, wanting to walk with us, saying and keeping the promise that Jesus told us that God would be with us to the end of the ages. This is in Matthew during the Great Commission, right? Jesus desires to be with us every single day, and that is the beauty of the name Emmanuel, right? God with us. There is no other God like this, that through love, unconditional love, that a God who sits on the throne in heaven desires to come down to be with us and eventually to die with us, for us, so that our future, our forever, may be together with God. And so today, I want that to be our prayer. I want that to be our hope. As we go into our Christmas season, I would like for us to let that word, Emmanuel, sink into our hearts, reminding you, number one, that God is with you. But at the same time, it's a daily journey that God is desiring to be with you. Every day, God is with you. From yesterday to today to tomorrow to forever. And I want to close with this passage from John chapter 17. It's the passage that we have today in our Bible reading challenge. John 17 would beautifully say, and it's the moments before Jesus is betrayed and crucified. Even though we as sinners, the people around him put him on the cross, he still says this prayer out of love. He prays this, verse 20 to 23, my prayer is not for them alone. I pray also for those who believe in me through their message, there as in the disciples, that all of them, that includes us, may be one. Father, just as you are in me, I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Isn't that prayer so beautiful? Again, the moments before Jesus is betrayed. He knows he's going to be betrayed. He knows that the world is full of sinners. But yet, because of God's love for us, because of Jesus' great love for us, he prays that Emmanuel would be manifested in us, that God would be in us, that we would be one with God, that we would be one with God, that it is a belief and a faith that if we believe in Jesus, that God is with us literally, and every single day is a life where we can know that Jesus will always be with us. So I pray and I lead us to go forth with this message of Emmanuel. Let that name sink into our hearts, that every day when we wake up, that we will say, God, I thank you for you are with me. When the moment we go to sleep, let's remind ourselves again, God, I thank you for being with me because I know that when I wake up, you're going to be with me again. Every single day we could declare this truth, and this truth will never change, that God is with us. And as we have lit these candles of hope, joy, love, and peace, why don't we also share this love as Jesus calls us to our neighbors? We are in a Christmas season, which oftentimes it's a season of giving. So let us give to our neighbors the good news that through hope, joy, love, and peace, we light the Christ candle on Christmas to signify that God is with us. Share with your neighbors that God is with you every single day, through the highs and the lows, through the good and the bad, the joys and the sadness. In all moments, God is with us. I was sharing before that, you know, we're also getting ready for the New Year's, and so we have a lot of 2023 resolutions, and I know for many of us, our 2023 resolutions will last probably 2 weeks, but a New Year's resolution, if that's what we're going to call it, that I would like for us to have is let us every single day remember, say to ourselves in the morning, in the afternoon, and at night that God is with us. And God desires to walk with us every single time. So let the word Emmanuel, the name Emmanuel, sink in our hearts this morning. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you so much for just this opportunity to just dive into the name Emmanuel. How it is truly a literal manifestation that God, you are with us. God, we pray, we thank you also that God with us is a reminder that you are with us. Yesterday, you are with us today, and you are with us tomorrow and forevermore. And let that truth really be sunk in our hearts deeply. As we continue our Christmas season, as we go into Christmas, as we go into New Year's, we pray that this would be the reminder that the birth of Jesus Christ is a testimony of the name Emmanuel, of how you are with us. So gracious God, we thank you and we truly just declare your love over us. And we just take a moment to be challenged to go forth sharing this love to those around us. We thank you, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. At this time, if you would stand with me, if able, to sing our closing song. We're going to declare, Angels We Have Heard on High, our red hymnal 238. We're going to sing all the verses, just declaring the name Emmanuel once again. Let us sing this together as we close our time.
Mountains in reply, echoing their joy.
Hear this blessing as we go forth with hope, joy, love, and peace. Gracious God, we thank you so much for this time that we could end our time singing glory to you. God, we once again let the name Emmanuel, God with us, sink in our hearts, that you are with us, and every day you long to be with us. God, we let this truth sing in our hearts as we go out, and now with the power of the Holy Spirit, going forth to share this love to one another. And so the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Amen. Go in peace.